Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Before we begin, I'm going to ask, please, if you would take a moment, make sure that your cell phone or other devices are turned off, and we will start. Again, good morning. My name is Joseph Espinoza. I'm the interim pastor here at Woodley Community Church. And on behalf of the Hanney family, I want to welcome you here in the name of our wonderful Savior. Let's begin our time in prayer. Almighty God, Father of lights, praise awaits you in Zion. Come, Lord, in the power of your Holy Spirit, and guide and strengthen us in this hour. This we ask in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, I invite Troy and Valerie to come and lead us in song.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out to turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Amen.
As long as I shine. served with Pastor Ron for many years, for slightly less than 21 years at Brooklyn Baptist Church in Santa Clarita, which you saw some pictures of. And I've known him for almost 40 years. I hired him as a youth pastor with that long hair in 1981 after he had received his degree from Biola University. Ron was born on November 25th, 1954, graduated to be with Jesus, his Savior, 66 years later on December 5th, 2020. He leaves his wife, Brenda, and three children, Amy Metzler, Brian, and Rebecca Hanney, as well as his parents, Ed and Nancy Hanney, and brothers Craig and Mark, and his sister, Denise Roberts. He also had two grandchildren, Felicity and Cassie, and I believe one coming along the way, or maybe soon. Primarily, Ron's ministry at Bokeh Baptist Church centered around the young people of the church and the community. He really had a heart for young people. Memorable to many of the youth in Santa Clarita that are now themselves already grown and have teenagers themselves of their own is Skeeter's Edge. We had a large cement quadrangle. The church was in the shape of an L, and it was all cemented in between. And Ron had skateboard ramps built and put them out there. And once a week, the kids would come in the afternoons after school, and they would skate and for a while. And then he would call them into the building and give them a snack and share with them a gospel or Bible message. And this ministry had a huge impact. For even the mayor of Santa Clarita at the time wrote him a letter thanking him for providing a skateboard venue for the youth of the city. That was before Santa Clarita had a skate park of its own. Ron also had a hot dog ministry at the nearby park during lunch break at Saugus High. It was an effective outreach, sharing the gospel with free hot dogs and many youth who still remark today about how it changed their lives. Ron was also invited or allowed on Saugus High campus, also allowed to come to football games and pray with the football team, not something probably that he could do today. 7 years after arriving at our church, Ron received his Master of Arts in Theology degree from Fuller Seminary, and he became our associate pastor, and he would fill in for me when I went on vacation. He also was ordained to the Christian ministry in September of 1988. But Ron was not only a colleague in the ministry, but he was a personal friend. And as you saw, there are pictures of us at some races. We often went to races together. I ran, sort of I jogged, and Ron ran. But we went to races together. Sometimes on the 4th of July, city would have a race. And there was one particular incident back in 1984 when the Olympics came to Los Angeles. Just before that, there was a Prince concert at a theater in Westwood. My niece went, and somebody drove up a car on the sidewalk and hit a bunch of people, including my niece. And so a few months later, they organized a race, a 10K race, to raise money for the victims of that accident, that tragedy. And so we entered together, Ron entered it with me, and it was a 10K. I don't know that I had run a 10K by then or not, but Ron obviously finished before I did, but the beautiful part of it was that once he had finished, he turned around and ran up the path and toward me and found me and encouraged me, because by that time I was ready to give up. So Ron was always, I found, an encourager. He did that many times at other races as well, would encourage me to keep going. He was known throughout Santa Clarita Valley for driving that 1963 Volkswagen, purchased in 1973 for $299. And Brenda made the comment that that was his only car that he ever drove, that was his alone. And any other cars he drove were for work or a family car. Brian has now inherited the Volkswagen to carry on the tradition. Ron began serving here at Woodley Community Church in November of 2003. He served here for 17 years as senior pastor. He was highly motivated in community outreach and established an aid to the homeless, a food pantry, and a clothing shed on the property. Ron was a man of integrity and compassion, who cared for those in need as well as his own, well as children and young people that were the subjects of his ministry. He loved the Lord Jesus. He served him faithfully. He loved his family deeply. And I'm sure when he arrived on heaven's shores, he heard the words on the front of some of your bulletins, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we come in your name this morning to remember our friend, to remember our pastor, to remember our father and our husband. We come to give you thanks for Ron and for the gift of his life. And we come to you this morning and acknowledge that you are the God of all comfort. And I'm praying, Lord, that you would comfort Brenda and Amy and Becky and Brian, Lord, and the family, brothers and sisters, Lord, at the loss of this wonderful man. We thank you that you have given us hope, that we are not hopeless. You care for all your people with an everlasting love. You are the God of all comfort, who consoles those that are suffering the death of a loved one. You are the God of all peace, who has promised to pour your perfect peace into the hearts of your children. We are going through the pain and suffering that the loss of a precious loved one brings. And so we're grateful this morning for the hope that is ours through Jesus Christ, which means that we are not here saying goodbye, but we're here because of Jesus' resurrection saying, "See you later." That is our hope. So Lord, draw near to us today as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. Oh, my soul. On singing, 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship is what all pain. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time is come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship his holy name. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh, my soul, I worship his holy name. I will worship his holy name. I will worship his holy name.
Things were always better than they seemed. Yet none of us ever wanted to burst his bubble. I miss his optimism and the way that you could always feel his joy and his energy when he came in the room. I miss how when we talk about things, he'd get passionate and hyper in his discussion, and we'd all start talking too loud, especially you, Hanney, know what I'm talking about. I miss how he'd always offer to pray for me when I was going through hard things. And he always had the best and most encouraging prayers. He seemed to know the right things to say. I miss seeing the special relationship that he had with Felicity, where they practically had their own little language. Happy trails, Dad. I'll always miss you.
From the dream, and the next morning I woke up to my mom's phone ringing. and it was the ICU, and they called to update us to tell us that in the early hours of the morning, they had administered CPR, and they brought him back. Needless to say, that was a little bit shocking, and I was in a stupor for a bit. But the next 2 days kind of followed the same. And that night, again, I went to bed. And in the middle of the night, I woke up, and I felt like my whole body was on fire. I felt sick, I felt nauseous, and I just felt like I was going to burst into flames. And eventually, I cooled down and went back to sleep. But that morning, again, we get a phone call. And it's the ICU with an update saying, hey, we've began rewarming your dad. He's doing okay. We started rewarming him in the middle of the night. And again, that was just something that kind of sat with me. The last night, after we had to say goodbye, I went to sleep, and again, I had a dream. I was walking out of the room, I looked into the kitchen, and I saw Dad sitting in his favorite spot with his coffee cup. Many of you know, and those of you who have been here with the church forever know that he had his mug and he would put a straw in it. Don't ask me why. Well, actually, you can ask me why. He thought that drinking the coffee out of a straw would keep his teeth from yellowing. But their dad was sitting at the kitchen table, looking so peaceful, sipping his coffee. And the thing that I noticed the most was this beautiful yellowish blue glow about him, as if he was wearing a white t-shirt in the sunlight. I'm gonna forever hold on to that image of my dad, because to me, with all of those events leading up, I knew that God was just confirming in my heart that Dad is in paradise, that he's gonna forever live in our memory, but there's that promise that we're gonna see him again. So I look forward to that day of seeing him again, and maybe I'll humor him and drink coffee out of a straw.
This on Facebook, and this little piece here has to be used at the same time, so we make sure we pick your voice up on the Facebook. So I'm going to open it this time. I know we have Andy Quinn, the executive minister of the American Baptist Churches for Los Angeles, Southwest, and Hawaii, is here with us today. Andy, I would invite you to come up first.
Thanks, Steve. A little story about Pastor Ron, but I want to give you some background first. As Steve mentioned, I'm with an organization, and Steve's leadership as well in this organization, that oversees some churches, about 200 churches, Hawaii, Arizona, Nevada, and Southern California. Several years ago, there was a group of people that said, hey, this might be a better deal if we change the scope and get the folks, the churches, out of the organization we're in. So they, banded together, and they decided they wanted to do ministry separate. Not such a rare thing for Baptists. But a rare thing for American Baptists, because we're just a voluntary association of churches. Churches don't have to belong, and the regions don't have to belong to to American Baptist churches. Why am I telling you all of this? It's because at the time that people were being sort of enticed to come over to where the grass was greener, and several pastors were kind of prairie dogging up to see, well, maybe it's better to go on over there. Pastor Ron refused and demonstrated just his absolute loyalty, not just to the organization, but to the church and to the God he serves. He is was a very loyal man. That's part of the equation. The other part is that he was a shepherd. When Jesus had breakfast with the apostle Peter on the shore, Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" And he asked him this question three times. And as a demonstration of that love, Jesus said, "Then feed my lambs, feed my sheep, feed my sheep." Pastor Ron was a loyal shepherd. He loved this church. He loved the people of God, young or old. He wanted to make sure that they had the journey that he had and the walk that he had and the love that he knew for his Savior. Just one final word. I reached out to my predecessor, Dr. Sam Chetty, and I asked him if he would give me a word about Pastor Ron, and he said this. He said, "I thank God for blessing us with Pastor Ron, a shepherd after his own heart. I miss seeing his cheerful face." Don't we all?
Thank you, Andy. I'm going to keep the mic open now, and if you'd like to come up and speak, you're more than welcome to come up. I want to set the tone a little bit by telling one of my stories about Ron. This is one of the very, very early days when he was here at Woodley. We had a meeting scheduled for Coco's down on Sepulveda Boulevard. He's late. I went outside to check on him. All of a sudden, I see a large truck at the street there, and I see this little brown Volkswagen come shooting around the truck. All of a sudden, the truck laid the horn on at the Volkswagen. Next thing I see is an arm come out of the Volkswagen like this. Ron parked his car, saw me standing there. He says, "Probably not one of the best things for your new boss to see you do, is it?" I said, "I can think of other ways I would have handled that." But Ron became a good friend of mine over the time here. Anybody else would like to share a memory of Ron in the spirit of keeping it light and celebrating his life? And I see Nikki has a hand up and Bill Tate has a hand up. Bill, I'm going to be sexist. Ladies first. You want to come up here? Okay, Bill, come on up. And folks, when you're up here with the mic, you're welcome to take your mask off.
Prayers to the family and the First Lady and the church. Thank you for bringing Pastor Ron here. You know, the old saying that opposites attract, that is such a true story. Here's a guy from Central Casting. He could have starred on Happy Days with Mothers Know Best, you know. And here I am, straight out of Compton, you know. When I first met Pastor Ron, I figured this is not going to work. Here's a guy from suburbia. I'm from the inner city, we don't have anything in common. But you know what? It worked out perfectly. He showed me how to be a man again. I overcame a drug habit I had for almost 40 years. He gave me my soapbox right here. I never had a soapbox in my life. And he used to tell me, he said, Bill, talk from the heart, from wherever you feel. Be honest. You know what? He made me a better person. I have 7 years sobriety right now. God has been good. Thank you. I thank Pastor Ron every day, you know, and I pray for the first lady in the family. And I say, Pastor Ron, thank you for all you've done, and you always be in my life. And to the church, thank you. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was very encouraging as well. And I'm just gonna miss that.
Thank you, Amanda. It's really, really interesting when you remember some of the things, the corny jokes especially. During service, I would always sit over here, and he would tell one of the jokes, and he looked at me to see if I was laughing. If I wasn't laughing, then he'd get this look on his face, like, okay.
Hi. And I'm his dearest favorite sister. He was an awesome big brother growing up, and I cherish every moment we spent together. Some of my favorite memories were cruising in his Volkswagen Bug to Taco Bell or the beach, and sneaking cookies out of Mom's hidden golden cookie tin. Ron always had this playful mischievousness about him, which he never outgrew. I will always remember him as a bright light emanating pure joy with that Santa Claus twinkle in his eyes. Qualities I think we were all born with, but have for the most part been forgotten. I have greatly missed the words, "I love you, dearest favorite sister," and his childlike giggle that always followed. Jesus said, "Unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." I am certain that my favorite oldest brother was welcomed with open arms. Ron's parents, my parents, his parents, were unable to be here today due to health concerns. They send their love and their support to each and every one of you, but especially to Brenda, Amy, Brian, and Bethany. Thank you.
Amen. Vermont, was I going to bring you the mic?
Oh, sorry.
Okay, I'll be right there. If there's anybody else that would like to speak and prepare. Oh, Troy, I'm sorry. Ooh. I thought you were coming up to play music.
Hello. My name's Troy. I used to be in the praise band here. And we were in the band for like 22 years, and I was a member of the musical ministry with Pastor Ron for 16 out of the 17 years. And I'm gonna keep it a little light because I want to tell you kind of my impressions when I first met Pastor Ron, because I knew we had an interim pastor, and then he was getting hired on, and I was a part of that team. I didn't really know much about him, so I remember walking in. And there's this dude with a Hawaiian shirt on. And I'm like, what? You can wear Hawaiian shirts in church? what did that happen? I honestly regret today not wearing a Tommy Bahama, because I can tell you I never owned one until I met Pastor Ron. And then I'm like, wow, they match up perfectly. There's no seam lines. It's, no wonder they're so expensive. Right? Now I love my Tommy Bahamas. I think I have like 5 or 6 of them. It's all because of him. I cannot see a Volkswagen Bug without thinking of him. Doesn't matter where, doesn't matter what year, doesn't matter. It's just, it's a bug, it's wrong. I remember he was the, we were at Thousand Pines. He was very big on men's ministry and just really engaging the men, on, on a neutral ground. You know, that's one of the things that, there we go. Okay, that was one of the things that Ron was really good at, which was kind of disarming you. Because, like, wearing the Hawaiian shirts in church, you know, he was the first guy, first pastor ever to tell me, hey, take a guitar solo. Go for it, play lead. What? That doesn't happen in church. We play standard slow stuff. Come on. But no, he wanted to rock it out. He always wanted us to play new stuff, bring new things, bring it faster, play electric, do a lead, all of that. He loved it. He was all about that. But he had a way of disarming people and kind of breaking down, you know, if you were in a situation where you were having trouble, what's the common denominator? Your faith, right? That's where we're all together, is in our faith. And I remember he was the first person to ever say, he used to always say this, I had a lot of really long, good conversations with him, and he would say, that's a good word. Like, that's a good word. You can hear it in your head, can't you, right now? That's a good word. You should get up and tell somebody that. And he brought me and Kurt to get up and do a to do a sermon one day. And nobody had ever done that before. Again, dead zone, sorry, there we go, there we go. But he was always somebody who could make you feel welcome. Not like, you know, he's bigger or better than because he was a pastor. He was just a brother in Christ. And he was, you know, you could talk to him and relate to him that way. And, you know, he was always about doing the outreach. I would say that, you know, he could be leaving here on a Sunday morning, and I say I give him $40 in, like, food cards for Subway or something. If he had to stop at the store, he was getting home with zero food cards because he would hand them out to people who were in need everywhere he went. It didn't matter where you were. You know, we had a lot of people that came to the church as a result of his outreach. And he would, it didn't matter where you were at in your life. You were welcome here. You know, we had a lot of members who are no longer with us, but were very special to us and were brought into that family as a result of Ron. So I'm gonna miss him. I love the guy, you know. I I'm so glad that you got that bug. Because I know your little boy's gonna be driving that bug with me. That's cool. So, circle of life. But anyway, I'm just very pleased and glad that I got to spend the time with him and know his family. So, it was an honor.
Dana.
Oh, sorry. I was focused on the dead zones.
We don't have dead zones with this little thing here. So, I'm going to go back and give Herman the mic for a moment. Herman is sitting in the back. If you want to turn and watch, or you can just sit here and listen to him. I'm going to put him on the spot. Everybody turn and look at Ron. Say, hi, Ron.
Hi, Ron.
I like to put people on the spot with things. So, Ron, I'm hoping there's no dead zone for this mic over here, but give it a try, okay?
I make it short, but I have met Pastor Ron when he started here 15, 16 years ago, and over the years he became just a very, very good friend, and in particular because both of us shared the concern about our church grounds and everything. And he even one of the latest things that we did together was we drove all the way to what is that city up in after Santa Clarita all the way north. Anyway, it was really the only Home Depot who had a lawnmower, a riding lawnmower. And he volunteered to come with me, and we put it on the truck, and we had such a good time. And the one other thing, highlight, Ron, he was actually, is it okay? Ron was performing the wedding with me and my wife, Linda, here, and I just have to say, Ron, he just became such a deep friend, and he is a people person, as you know, as everybody else said. And I can only say, I miss him so, so very much. And there's almost not a day going by that I think about him. Thank you very much.
I remember Ron when I asked him to perform my renewals on my 25th wedding anniversary. He's going like, whoa, 25 years? You know that look, that whoa, that Ron always does. Sir.
Spent a lot of hours together in the garage, customizing, trying to get more horsepower out of these little Volkswagens to the point where they got dangerous. That's almost where that little brown one is of Ron's today. But in most of my adult life, Ron and I have lived far apart. I've lived in Washington State for the last 27 years or so. But despite that, and kind of moved down the path of different paths in life, Ron entering into the ministry early on. I entered into the business world, but we were both young believers in Jesus. So that was always common. There came a point in my career where the business side came to an end a little over 10 years ago, and I began putting kind of a full-time effort into various forms of ministry. And in recent years, Ron and I have spent a lot of hours on the phone, and our topic ultimately is how do we help people know Jesus more deeply, not theologically, not factually, but experientially. How do we help people get to that place, because we have experienced it. You knew how transformative it was. And we talked about the struggles in ministry and encouraged one another, and they were rich times. And this happened a lot. Thinking about this time as we gather here today in honor of her, I wonder what Ron might say to us if he could be with us for a brief time. I know he'd express his love to all of you. But I think he'd be like Jesus. You know, when Jesus was still on earth in the last days, still in resurrected form, Scripture tells us in the first chapter there of Acts that Jesus was meeting with his disciples. And Scripture tells us that of all the things that Jesus could have talked about, he talked about the kingdom of God. And I've always interpreted that to understand that Jesus was saying, here I am in resurrected form, if there's not proof enough, but I'm testifying to you that all I've said is true. And I think Ron would say that to us today. He would get that knowing smile across his face that you've all seen, that twinkle come to his eye. And say it's all true. All that he's been speaking to us, all he's been speaking to you, all the word of God that he has revealed to you, he'd say to you, it's all true. And it's amazing to be in the presence of Jesus today. Now, I can't imagine Ron knowing he is the shepherd that he is. He couldn't pass up the opportunity to exhort us and to encourage us as he always does. And maybe not unlike the Apostle Paul as he closed out his first letter to the Corinthian church. Ron would be telling us, in spite, with all that you know, with all these truths of God's word, the promises that he's given to us, he'd be saying, now I want you to be watchful. Be alert. Don't miss the signs of the times. Don't be confused. Don't forget Jesus is coming again. Be firm in your faith then. Be strong. Don't yield to fear and confusion. Don't follow the declining ways of this world, but continue to faithfully pursue God. Cooperate with the work of the Holy Spirit in your life to transform you. And do all that you do in the love of Jesus. Stay strong in community. Keep loving one another. And then to his friends and his acquaintances that have not yet decided to follow Jesus, Ron might say, friends, look at my example. You don't know how many days you have left. Please set aside your foolish pride. Receive all that Jesus has done for you. Be reconciled to God, right? Be at peace with him for eternity. Don't waste another day trying to do life without Jesus, but give your life to him. Let him be Lord. Allow him to begin to transform your life in all the ways your truest heart most deeply desires. Do it today. Don't waste another day. You may not have tomorrow. And I want to say personally thanks to all of you who have loved him well, encouraged him, supported him over all these years of ministry. And as has been said and expressed, yes, we mourn deeply his lack of presence with us today. But we don't mourn as those who have no hope. Rather, we know with confidence and I think with a deep spiritual affirmation how the Spirit has moved throughout this time, as much as Becky had shared earlier. But we will see Ron again for eternity, and we'll all be in the presence of Jesus, and we'll once again see that knowing smile and those twinkling eyes. So we celebrate that fact today, both for us and for Ron. Thank you. God bless.
As Troy and Valerie come up to prepare for our final song, we have time for one more if anybody else would like to speak. If not, I'm going to share a Ron joke for you. This is truly a Ron joke. He said it from the pulpit one Sunday morning. What does a dentist who gets an award receive? A little plaque.
Say a couple of things just very briefly because I sing a lot better than I speak. But I remember a similar story that he told in one of his sermons, maybe before his sermons, about, and I don't know all the details, again, I'm not a good speaker, but I do know that he said he was traveling somewhere in LA, I want to say by the airport. I know he had Becky in the car with him. And he shared about somebody that had cut him off and a little bit of a mishandling, so to say, of his emotions with that. And he shared with us that it was Becky that wasn't condoning of whatever it was that he did. I don't know how Becky expressed that to him, but he did share that it was his, he had a little bit of shame in that it was his young daughter who grounded him in that situation. And I remember so being so shocked that, you? I don't know what you did, but he wasn't proud of himself. I know that there were two occasions. One occasion we come perfectly prepared to do our worship set, and on two occasions, one time he said, "Hey Val, do you have a cowboy song? Because we're cowboys today." That's not the way we work, but we somehow managed a cowboy song. And another time, same situation, "Hey Val, do you got like a Mexican themed song? Because we're at Taco Day." So when you say mischievous and Ron, I don't know. And the final thing I wanted to share was, I had heard at some point that he considered the city of Granada Hills his mission field. And I didn't understand that, and I do today. Listening to everything I didn't have the opportunity to know about, I understand a lot more of how he could feel that way and all of the work that he put in to make sure to minister to his mission field. I can't imagine losing somebody that had was so engaged with every part of his family, because that's not the kind of family that I was raised in. And I'm listening to the family speak and the family stories, and I can't begin to say that I understand your pain and your loss. And I'm sorry for that. And I hope that God continues to comfort and lift you up and make you smile rather than feel the pain when you do remember your dad and your brother and your husband. Because he was surely there in every moment, in every way, in ways that I heard today, just unbelievable to me. So thank you for sharing Pastor Ron with us. Amen.
To the garden alone, who is still, and the voice I hear falling on my ear.
Yeah.
Pastor Joseph comes up to prepare to close our time together, I did want to take a moment and share some comments from folks that are watching on Facebook. Shelly Coe says, my kids remember him fondly. Love you, Captain Ron. Look forward to seeing you again one day. And my brother Dana Bates says, I wish I could be there for this. What a great man Pastor Ron was, always encouraging and fun to be with, always willing to pray for someone and to do street ministry. He loved with all of his heart. I think about him every day. Thank you, Dana.
Pastor Joseph?
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful, Lord God, not only for your love and tender mercies and faithfulness, but for your servant, Lord, and the example that he was and the challenge that we have. Lord, we too desire to be more like you. We too desire to be more sensitive to those around us. Thank you, Lord, for those like our brother who were such an example. Lord, and thank you for those that have come today. Bless and guide us as we move forward. We give you the glory, we give you the praise, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would please stand for the benediction. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord bless you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. And if you would like, we are going to share luncheon together in the education building. You are dismissed. God bless you.